Hi, this presentation will be narrated by me, Lisha, speech therapist from Sengkang Health,
and me, Jody from Changi General Hospital. We'll be touching on post-stroke dysphagia.
By the end of this presentation, you should be able to meet these four objectives. 1. Understand normal swallowing. 2. The oral and pharyngeal changes post-stroke. 3. Be aware of the signs of dysphagia which might lead to aspiration. And 4. The ST's role in dysphagia management. This chart gives an overview of the areas that a speech therapist covers for stroke patients, but this presentation will focus on swallowing. Pre-oral phase. Swallowing actually starts before food and drink enters your mouth. Your sense of smell picks up the aromas of the food. An element of cognition is involved because you need to be aware and recognize that it's a smell of food. The salivary glands gets activated, and you also prepare the position of your mouth and tongue to receive the food. Therefore, elements of smell, sight, and cognition are required for the pre-oral phase. Now we're going to talk about when food enters the mouth. This is an image of the lateral view of the head and neck region. Here are the lips, teeth, tongue, soft palate, epiglottis. This is down towards the lungs, and this is the esophagus at the back. The first phase is the oral phase. This stage is where food is broken down. Lip closure will stop the food from spilling out, and the tongue is an important muscle as it helps move the food between the teeth where mastication takes place. It also prevents food and drink from spilling backwards into the pharynx. Buccal muscles and muscles of the jaw will help break down the food. There's a lot of muscle recruitment within the oral cavity which we don't think about every time we eat or drink. Then, the tongue forms a cohesive bolus and the soft palate stops food and drink from going into the nasal cavity. The bolus then enters the pharynx, travels to the back of the mouth. The epiglottis flexes downwards to seal off the entrance to the airways. This consequently results in a period of apnea. The bolus gets directed straight down to the esophagus. With the help of the esophageal muscles, peristalsis occurs, directing the bolus all the way down to the stomach, as you can see here.
Dysphagia is a medical term for having difficulties in swallowing. Some stroke patients might find eating, drinking, and taking medications difficult.
Okay, I'm going to introduce you to some terms that we use. Penetration is when food goes down the wrong way, meaning it enters the airways, but does not go past the vocal folds. As you can see in this picture, the bolus sits on top of the vocal folds. Aspiration is the term we use when food goes past the point of the vocal folds. As you can see, the red circle is now below the line of the vocal folds. For a normal swallow, a cough reflex would kick in and expel the bolus out. However, silent aspiration occurs when there isn't a cough reflex present. In such instances, we cannot be sure if aspiration has taken place. For example, medullary strokes put the patient at high risk of silent aspiration.
Stroke can give rise to motor difficulties. For example, those who have suffered from a cerebellar stroke may have difficulties coordinating their muscles, and those who have been diagnosed with pure motor strokes may have decreased muscle movements or muscle paralysis. This will affect their chewing, and they may have poor oral control and affect their swallowing. We also know that a stroke can affect cognition. Cognitive deficits can also contribute to dysphagia. The patient may have poor attention and get easily distracted. They may have a reduced awareness of food and drink in the mouth and may not be able to sustain attention during their meals. Here are some common signs and symptoms of oral dysphagia or difficulties in the oral phase. Food loss from mouth, unable to chew, pocketing of food in the sides of the mouth, and bits of food left in the mouth after swallowing. For pharyngeal phase difficulties, you may see nasal regurgitation, which is food and drink coming out of nose, complaints of food being stuck in the throat, repetitive swallowing on a single spoonful, coughs before, during, or after swallow, throat clearing before, during, or after swallow, changes in voice quality, and shortness of breath.
Consequences of dysphagia. You can get aspiration pneumonia, which is a chest infection as a result of food and fluids entering the lungs, malnutrition or dehydration, the inability to take required medications, and some psychosocial consequences as well. For example, the fear of eating out and social isolation.
Signs of dysphagia can occur in up to 78% of patients with stroke. Ideally, a formal swallowing evaluation should be performed by speech therapists, but this can be impeded by a lack of resources and time conflicts, making it difficult for speech therapists to assess each and every patient prior to allowing them diet. Nurses then play a part by helping to conduct a simple routine bedside swallowing test for patients who have been admitted for acute stroke. All water swallowing tests aim to capture patients at risk for dysphagia by either passing or failing them. Before they can assess patients themselves, nurses have to be trained and assessed by the speech therapists as well. There are various water swallowing test protocols available, and different institutions use different protocols. Each water swallowing test has its own exclusion criteria of patients whom nurses are not allowed to perform the swallowing test on. For example, patients with brainstem strokes, tongue deviation, prior history of dysphagia, and so on. For patients who pass the swallowing test, nurses still have to watch for signs of aspiration, especially during mealtimes. Patients who have failed the swallowing test would be kept near by mouth and referred to the speech therapist for a more formal swallowing evaluation.
What can STs do? Adjust the environment to facilitate a safe swallow. We also modify fluid consistencies and dietary texture to reduce and prevent incidences of aspiration. We can give inputs on the need for enteral feeding, and we can teach patients swallow rehab. The top picture shows thermotactile stimulation using a cold spoon, one of the swallow rehab techniques we do. We are of course part of a multidisciplinary team, and we work with other professionals to provide better care. Just for example, we work closely with the dietitians to discuss nutritional intake. OTs can provide information on the patient's cognitive function, PTs for patient's chest status, and so on.
In conclusion, stroke can result in swallowing and communication difficulties. Speech therapies help to manage patients with dysphagia and improve their quality of life. If you recognize any of the signs and symptoms as mentioned earlier, please consult the speech therapist for assessment.
That's the end of our presentation on post-stroke dysphagia. Thank you for listening.